Well, hello everyone, and thank you for joining us for this very special Black History Month edition of the Lobo Living Room. I'm Chad Cooper. I'm president of the UNM Alumni Association, and I'm here in beautiful Hodgen with some friends of mine, Mike Silva, our incoming president for the association, and Dean Harris Smith, UNM's dean for the College of Fine Arts. So welcome everybody. It's great to have you both here to have this this important conversation about music and the arts and their impacts in Black culture. So welcome, Dean Smith. Good to see you again.
Yeah, thank you. It's good to be here. This is my second trip here, so
right.
I'm feeling like I'm part of the family
yeah,
here.
Yeah.
So
good. Thank it's you. Always good to be at Hodgen Hall.
Yeah, for sure. And just to have this conversation with the two of you, because of your histories, obviously Dean Smith with in the arts and running our College of Arts and Sciences, and Mike, your background. Right, and music and, yeah. and ska, and I know you have a rich history.
Big part of my life.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And had a lot of impact on your life too.
Yeah, for sure. So, changed some things for me.
For sure. So for hundreds of years, music has impacted Black culture, right? Mm-hmm. Whether it was enslaved peoples, free people, and the way that we've used music to express a myriad of feelings, right? Happiness and joy and sorrow and that history that helped create the blues and helped create jazz. Being from New Orleans, that's important to me. But in general, Black music, African American music has had a significant impact on America's musical heritage. Mm-hmm. It's been the voice of grace and sadness and anger and all these different things. But it's also had an impact on what we would consider to be Afrofuturism, mm-hmm. right? So Dean Smith, can you talk a little bit about that, Afrofuturism, what that is? I think I heard the term for the first time a couple of weeks ago talking.
Which is interesting, I'll bring it up later. Well, I might as well bring it up now that Afrofuturism has experienced a resurgence and has become more popular than ever because of the success of Black Panther. And then the Oscar-nominated or Oscar award-winning Spider-Man into the mm-hmm. Spider-Verse. So that's how most people know it. But to break it down so everyone understands, I just brought the definition so everyone completely understands what we're talking about. So Afrofuturism is a cultural aesthetic that combines science fiction, history, and fantasy to explore the African-American experience and aims to connect those from the Black diaspora with their forgotten African ancestry. So in short, it's an art form that helps empower not just African Americans, but people of color. Mm-hmm. And this came out of the idea or the response that I know for me, and I think every Black artist goes through this, for me as an actor, you would watch these TV shows or science fiction shows and there weren't any people of color, or at least Black people in these science fiction films. You start asking yourself, well, it looks like I'm not part of the conversation in the future, mm-hmm. right? And so there was a lot of response that came out of that. And it goes back, actually, the history goes back to the 50s as far as music goes. Before I get to that, I'll give other examples and I'll get back to music. So for visual arts, now, currently, you have Stacey Robinson and John Jennings, who created our creative artists for Black Kirby Comics. So Jack Kirby was a well-known comic book illustrator, and Stacey Robinson and John Jennings are African-American artists, and they've created these Black comic book characters that help empower, African Americans to see themselves in the future and to see themselves as these heroic characters that usually were Eurocentric characters. And then within media, of course, you have Black Panther, right? Good example. In theater, Yale, just 2 years ago, Yale Rep did Shakespeare's Twelfth Night, and they did it as an Afrofuturistic play using. You could see influences of Parliament and Funkadelic and those, the more recent bands that people are aware of. And it was an interesting play, right, to see. And then with dance, of course, you have hip hop and breakdancing that came from the idea of Afrofuturism and traditional African dance as well. And then moving back to music, as I had mentioned before, you have Sun Ra, The Roots. You had mentioned a couple, actually, Mike, that bands that I wasn't aware of. And I can't remember who the folks you had brought up that have that influence.
Yeah, I'll have to. It'll come back to me.
Yeah.
I'm glad you mentioned Park Funkadelic, because as you were talking, I keep thinking about George Clinton.
Videos.
From back in the day, and then you know, obviously Black Panther's huge, not necessarily from a music standpoint, but just being able to see you know, Black people expressed as you know, leaders of technology and sort of these futuristic type cities. And I know Mike had some influence with actually getting some of our kids to see that.
Yeah,
a couple years ago.
A few years ago we bought out a movie theater here in Albuquerque, and we rounded up about 110 kids from area schools. Myself, Chad, and four other of our friends, and we bought out the theater and provided as much popcorn as they could eat and slushies until they couldn't slushy anymore. We all sat in there and watched that movie together, and it was one of the most powerful things I've ever been a part of. I mean, when the movie ended, we were all clapping and cheering and just so excited, and there was 100 Black and brown kids sitting there staring at the screen, looking at this man and these Black women that, you know, look like people in their homes and in their neighborhoods. And it was a bit of an emotional moment for me. I was sitting next to Nick Miller, I think, and he was with his son. And we were both sitting up there as the movie was ending, and everybody was clapping, and we were both kind of like holding back the tear of joy, you know, that we were able to do that for these kids. It was awesome. That representation, you know, it's essential.
And two, not just being able to see a hero on stage that looks like you, right? But also kind of getting back to your point, Dean, about this whole futuristic concept of possibilities and what can be. And, you know, talk a little bit more about that, if you can, about, you know, this concept and how it's impacted the music and the arts and how that's kind of made its way through and impacted Black culture and American culture in general.
Well, it's given us an opportunity to, I guess, engage in more dialogue and what the future looks like for us as Black people and being part of the larger conversation. A little bit of a side note for me, you mentioned you hadn't heard about Afrofuturism or heard of the term till a couple of weeks ago. It was the same for me. I think after Black Panther came out, I was talking with a friend. They were talking about Afrofuturism and the point that, well, you know, the stage combat, because my background is in fight direction and stage combat. And they said, well, you know, actually the choreography is more Eurocentric. That took place in Black Panther. So it urged me to start doing research into, well, then what does it mean if we start incorporating Afrofuturistic values or aesthetics into stage combat? So I'm in the middle of exploring that, where I want to get together folks with a background in African dance, in stage combat, and bring those folks together and say, well, if we truly embrace those values of respect, valuing the human being, the being of a human, well, how does Afrofuturism influence how I'm going to choreograph a fight that's based on Afrofuturism, to help tell that story and share our culture as African diaspora for the folks here in our country, and what does that look like? And again, to help empower and get conversation going around that and dialogue. And it's just one small aspect, right? Again, the arts in general, you know, through music, you know, it's been that's the oldest form of it, because they've been able to do that through music and creating that conversation. You know, again, think of other folks, Jimi Hendrix, Earth, Wind & Fire, Commodores, even Stevie Wonder touched on it. The impact that it can have and how it can empower people is what you can't put a price on the human spirit, right? And I think the arts has a way of empowering people.
Every revolution has to have art. Mm-hmm. You know, it's all, every revolution is powered by art and music. I mean, historically, if you go back and look, you'll find that. I was talking with my brother, he's in Columbus, Ohio these days, and I was talking to him recently about some of this stuff, and we ended up going off on a long conversation about the history of revolutions in America and how there always is some connection to art and music fueling every revolution. Hey, so Dean Smith, you know, with this being kind of the year of the Black Lives Matter movement, there's been all these conversations about the need for unity and healing. How do you see this Afrofuturism playing a role in that?
Ah, good question. Again, really, you know, music, well, first of all, we were moving in that direction and then the pandemic hit. So that just put a brake on everything in some ways, but it's also brought attention to the movement and to the struggle. So I just can't wait for this pandemic.
Yeah.
Not that it's just going to go away magically, but moving forward, it's a great opportunity for artists to respond to the pandemic and how it's impacted them as African Americans, because there's already conversation out there with like the vaccine.
It's different.
And that you know, folks of color aren't being represented in those groups that are getting vaccinated. But it also opens the opportunity to have dialogue and artists to respond, the response to the pandemic, to talk about through visual arts, again, the performing arts, dance, music, poetry. It's a great way to start healing ourselves and engaging in conversation again, and asking those universal questions of where do we fit in our country as Black men, women, and children. And that conversation's been going on. I wish I could remember the name of the artist. I sat in on arts. They had a virtual exhibition with an African-American artist, and her work is mainly mixed art forms.
Yeah.
And it was a great dialogue, great conversation that she had created and our art department had created. So yeah, there's many, many ways that Afrofuturism can help us, you know, add to the dialogue and help us move forward as people and educate people who look at us as stereotypes. Mm-hmm. Growing up, you know, in the 60s and 70s, when we go talk about media again, right? I'm thinking about, you know, the stereotypes you saw back then, Starsky and Hutch, mm-hmm. Sugar Bear?
Mm-hmm. Huggy Bear.
Sugar Bear. You know, and these stereotypes, and me growing up in rural Washington, you know, 20 minutes north of Seattle, as far enough outside of Seattle that, you know, folks never interacted with Black people. So I would have people come up to me trying to put me into a stereotype, and they'd say, hey, what's up, my brother?
Yeah.
A white person, I'm like, hey, how's it going? I'm just a person just like you,
yeah,
you know?
Well, that still happens to me.
Yeah. Oh, no, really?
Yeah.
So, you know, these stereotypes where people want to fit us into a box, but bring it back to Afrofuturism and specifically music, that we don't fit into a little box.
No.
We're complex human beings
exactly.
like anyone else. You know, and that's why I bring up Hendrix, you know, Jimi Hendrix. Mm-hmm. He's credited with inventing the electric guitar because he showed everyone what you could do with that instrument.
Right.
And the other groups that you talked about, some Black rock bands.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, for I've really been diving deep in last month. One of my inspirational bands is a band called Fishbone. Fishbone is a bunch of brothers from South Central Los Angeles. Grew up in the hood. You would expect them to, maybe if you're playing stereotypes, to become the next Public Enemy.
Mm-hmm.
But instead they picked up some instruments and they started playing ska music, punk music. And because they were this kind of hard-edged band, they didn't really fit on the Black channels and the Black radio, so they couldn't get really airplay there. But then the white rock stations didn't really know what to do with them because they weren't long-haired white dudes in the 80s and 90s playing basically heavy stuff. So they kind of were left in this gray area of really couldn't get any airplay, couldn't really secure and keep record deals that they were worthy of because records weren't moving as well because they couldn't get the radio support. Music is different now where, you know, you stream everything and it, you measure things that way. But back then, the measurables were in your record sales and your tickets, ticket sales at your gates of your events. And Fishbone was always this kind of, what do we do with these guys? There's a bunch of black dudes up here just killing it on their instruments, but they're playing heavy kind of punk rock type stuff with this ska and reggae groove. People were just confused. And they have actually, over the last few months, approached that very head on. And if you follow them at all, they've been talking directly to that, Matt, to that point. And there's some frustration you can hear from them about how they're 30 years into their career, and yet they're still kind of trying to find their place because of being black men playing the music they play. It's this big mystery, right? But they're heroes of mine for their kind of courageous attempt at their courageous approach to just play music that mattered to them. And, you know, whatever comes from it, comes from it.
Yeah, it's interesting you say that, because we tend to want to compartmentalize the type of music that people play based on how they look, right?
Yeah. And,
you know, you mentioned Fishbone. I remember Living Color,
yep.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
The Cult of Personality, one of the greatest rock songs ever. And you see this dude, you know, this brother on stage with these long dreads, and he's just banging his head. So he's not just playing the music, but he's up there like banging his head, and his hair's flying around everywhere. And it just, I remember that just blowing me off the stage. But then, too, on the flip side, I remember as a kid and growing up in the 80s, you also had like the emergence of the Beastie Boys. And I remember being in a private school where I was, you know, one of the only black kids in my school. And my white friends were struggling at times to place the Beastie Boys and trying to figure out if they should be doing this kind of music too. So, you know, it kind of goes all ways. But, you know, Mike, you mentioned Fishbone and ska. Talk a little, I know you played music and you were in bands. Can you talk a little bit about how music has influenced you and your life?
Yeah, well, significant for me, you know, growing up, I was born and raised in South Central Los Angeles, lived there until just before third grade when we moved to Albuquerque. And, you know, we kind of came here in a bit of a stressed out, you know, survival type situation. Mom saw that where we were wasn't really working for us. So she brought us out here to get a fresh start. And at that time, I was already playing an instrument. And my musical journey has been an interesting one. My grandfather, we were living in LA, but my grandfather somehow, I still don't know how, but he was into the ranchera music, you know? And so here I was, this little black kid walking through South Central LA, and I was the only one in the whole hood with an accordion, right? So I'm dragging this big old accordion around, and I'm a small guy. I'm a tiny kid, but I'm dragging this accordion around every day. And what it taught me was just the to take pride in something, because I realized that I was good, and I started to win some medals and awards at these little festivals and things. And so I started to take a lot of pride in the music, and it gave me something to have purpose. It was a purpose. It gave me something to strive for, something to look forward to, something to achieve at, and it became my thing. You know, I was relatively athletic, but you know, at 5'6", 5'7" in high school and in, you know, middle school, I knew I wasn't going to the league, insert league. So I knew that the music was potentially the way that I would be able to further move my life forward. So played some high school basketball, but I quit because I wasn't going anywhere with that long term. So music became the thing. By then, I'm playing saxophone, and I fell in love with reggae because of its social messages. Bob Marley's a hero of mine to this day. The man was so much more than just a musician. He was a pioneer in so many ways. And he's been gone for decades and still is so relevant today because of the messages that he spoke in his music and the courage he showed when he stood up against the man and the oppressor man to speak his truth to power. He did it through music. And so that fueled me even further, led me to kind of fall in love with some type of music called ska. My love for ska music really became the bedrock of my musical life, because those bands were multiracial. Those bands were multi-ethnic. Those bands were people that came together for the love of the music, and nothing else really mattered. But in the 80s, when ska music was kind of finding its groove here in America, it was taking a lot of its roots and its notes from bands in the 60s and 70s out of England that were these white poor Englishmen and these black poor Jamaicans that had come to England to find a better life, they ended up in the ghettos and they started playing all this music together, and nothing else mattered. And it was the power of the music. It brought them all together. It eased racial strife. You know, England was going through some stuff at that time with Margaret Thatcher, but the music spoke to that and it addressed it, and it was fearless and it was courageous, and it gave the people in the ghettos there something to rally around. And for me, it gave me music something to rally around. It pushed me forward and helped me basically to get to the point where I could have some courage and some confidence in myself and come to UNM, go to school here, play in the bands, you know, came here as a music major. And still to this day, one of the glories of the pandemic for me has been, with the free time that I've had, I've been able to dive back into my music, where the last 10 years or so, I really haven't been able to because of my businesses. I let those things take the priority, and I've been missing something. My soul has been aching a little bit. But with the pandemic, I'm playing music again, and I've been writing. I've been collaborating with a friend of mine, and we've been putting some tracks down. And now I'm just doing the music for the love of the music, you know. 30 years ago, I was trying to get a record deal. It would have been a whole different type of stress and pressure. Now I'm just enjoying the music. And I've got some stuff that I've written that I'm pretty proud to release eventually here pretty soon, just for the fun of it, you know, again, just to see how people react to the music. And it's, if you know me, you know it's going to speak to what's going on in the world. So my music is going to be very directed at the humanity that we are lacking, the love we have for our fellow man and woman, and about the power of our unity, the power of our strength. The visual that I always go to is being a musician on stage. And I've been fortunate enough to be on stages where there's 25,000 people in the crowd. And I'm on stage and I'm playing, and the band that I'm in is multiracial. And we're playing music and I'm looking out into the crowd, and the crowd is completely diverse, totally inclusive. That's the nature of ska and reggae music. It's incredibly diverse. It's incredibly inclusive. And I'm on stage playing my music, and I'm looking out into a crowd that looks like me, looks like my band, singing my songs back to me. And in that moment and in that space, there's nothing that matters but the music. Nothing else. Skin color, sexuality, none of that matters. We're all just one big happy family in that moment. So it's the power of music. It's incredible. And if we, you know, listen to the messages in the music and try to live that, I think we got a better chance.
Yeah, that's great. No, it's true. It's true. And it's interesting to hear you say how going back to the music in a lot of ways is therapeutic, right?
It's my
especially
journey.
As an artist.
Absolutely. Yeah.
As an artist, it's therapeutic. Yeah. And for somebody who's not an artist, or basically somebody that has zero musical talent at all, that'd be me. Being a listener of music in times of difficulty is also therapeutic. You know, you can go back through, you know, civil rights movement, you know, change is going to come, you know, through, you know, the emergence of hip hop and, you know, the message, right? You know, don't push me because I'm close to the edge, and, you know, and then, you know, all the way through, you know, Public Enemy, Fight the Power, you know, there's always these messages about, social justice,
right?
Which is the revolution that Mike was kind of talking about.
Right.
That it takes on different forms, right? Because I look back at rock and roll, right?
Yeah.
That was the parents from the 50s were, you know, oh my goodness, right? Rock and roll. And then to me, I've always told people, rap is the new rock and roll. It's pushed the limits. It's it's the youth again finding their voice and throwing it in our face and challenging us to change, which make people uncomfortable again.
Yep.
The language is strong and passionate because that's how they're feeling. And then it also goes back to that cultural crossover. You're talking about Beastie Boys.
Yeah.
Well, now, you know, it doesn't matter who you are. You know, music is that universal language.
Yep.
And rap and hip hop is a big part of that. Now you have kids in the hood and kids in
suburbs,
well-to-do suburbs.
Yeah.
They're all listening to rap. You pull up next to a kid
in
their, you know, brand new Mustang that mom and dad got them, and they're listening to rap. They're finding their voice.
And if that's their entryway into learning and wanting to engage black culture and black people, then so be it.
Well, rap is poetry, right?
Yeah.
And it goes back to what you were saying about you know, poetry being one of those methods to stimulate dialogue. And, yeah. and we had the one of the best examples, what, a few weeks ago at the inauguration poem.
Yeah.
You know, we're still talking about that, you know, yeah. about being rays of light and whether or not we have the courage to be the light. Right?
Yeah.
I mean, that's poetry, creating dialogue and inspiring people to be better.
People still talking about that poem weeks later.
Yeah.
And it took that young lady from already an accomplished poet and well-known to now she's part of the American lexicon at this point.
Yes.
Yeah.
And that's the revolution. I mean, she's art. Yeah. And she's now forever a part of American history. And, you know, if you speak our truth, every one of us has a different one. Some of us will speak it through poetry. Some of us will speak it through music, playing an actual instrument. Some of us will speak it through listening to music and sharing that message with the people in and around us. So, you know, it comes in all forms to those of us that are willing to listen and be courageous enough to step out and speak to it. That's that power of the arts, you know? It's just so important. And where current American school systems are cutting back on those things because of budgetary issues.
Yeah.
You know, to me, that's incredibly critical that we try to find ways to get the music and the arts back into schools. I'm in third grade and fourth grade playing my saxophone every day. And if I didn't have that saxophone, it would have been a whole different road for me because I was an angry, angry kid just trying to figure out life. I've been a whole lot of loss in my life by that point, a tremendous amount of loss by that point. But that saxophone was my thing. And to have not had that opportunity is really, really tough. And I know I was recently visiting the elementary school here in Albuquerque that I went to. And the new principal, I'm talking to her and she's walking me around the school a little bit. And I said, oh yeah, that's where I used to go to band. She's like, we don't have a band anymore. Ugh, I just broke my heart because, you know, they've cut the music. So, you know, personal mission of mine is try to find some way to get the music back in front of these kids. It's something for them to hang on to and feel good about.
Yeah, yeah. That blows me away. And it's heartbreaking, you know, especially for me, somebody who grew up in New Orleans, you know, there's this great meme that I have on my phone, and it's this little, you know, 3-4-year-old boy, and it says, you know, New Orleans daycares be like, and this is 3-year-old just blowing up.
That's great.
You know, these kids, you know, you grow up playing music.
Yeah.
I mean, you go some of these high schools in the South or, you know, where I'm in New Orleans, and it's cooler to be in the band than it is to be on the football team, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, I remember growing up going to some of these games, like wanting to be in the band, you know, rather do that than play football or be on the field. I mean, now granted, I had no musical ability, so football was, you know, one of the...
We could have found a role for you.
Yeah, you and me both.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Could have been the one marching with, holding the banner,
the
right?
The symbols.
But, you know, but it's such a pervasive element of the culture, you know, being able to play music, sharing music, and creating all those emotions that are around it is huge.
And again, media being a big part of that. When what was the movie that came out that kind of put the HBCs and the marching bands?
Drumline.
Yeah, Drumline. When that came out, again, it was a great opportunity to share our culture with the rest of the world. That even again, I'm up north. I'm up in the Northwest, right? And growing up in the 70s, and to see Drumline, it was amazing to me.
I remember being in the marching band in high school, you know, here in Albuquerque. And our band director was this really young guy, really young, very traditional marching band type of guy. And, you know, I'm starting to feel my blackness a little bit. And I remember a couple times, I was like one of two or three black kids in the whole band. But I remember a couple times we would be marching in practice and I would just step out and do a little bit of the HBCU stuff. You know, I'd seen like Grambling on TV the week before, or Southern's marching band or something. And I remember just trying to do a little bit of that and hope not to get caught in practice. Mike Silva!
But that was one of the most exciting things was...
get back in line.
Yeah.
God, it must have been like 10 years ago now that Southern University came and played here.
At the
played the football game. Well, they played the football game against the Lobos back back when
Coach Lotson
was still here, and they brought the band.
Oh, man.
And that was just huge. And you know, the band, you know, they did their thing. They played, you know, 20-minute set and danced on the field and everything. And it had to be like 100 degrees outside. And they were full-on uniform. And then, you know, going to your point about Drumline, probably about 3 or 4 years ago, the musical came to Popejoy.
Yeah.
And which was just completely mind-blowing, because it was after the movie and it was sort of loosely based on the movie, but it was really talking about the history of the drumlines and the history of music in HBCUs. And just giving all these different examples. But the best part of that was at the end, they actually did a second line out of Popejoy. And at the end of the show, they do the second line out of Popejoy. Everybody's dancing. The entire crowd is dancing out of Popejoy. And they finish off the entire crowd just dancing in the lobby of Popejoy.
Oh, that's amazing.
And they're playing the second line song. They're playing Do What You Wanna by the Rebirth Brass Band out of New Orleans, which is, you know. So I'm in there, you know, in the lobby, like second line and dancing. And it was just, it was mind blowing that they would bring something like that.
So. That's amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah. I forgot when you brought that up. I forgot. I said, yeah, you know, I didn't know much about it. So I'm in rural Seattle, out in the boonies. And Garfield was a band from the inner city. Mm-hmm. And they played Bothell High School. Mm-hmm. And they came in with the attitude and marching. And I'm just remembering that now. And the folks and the look on their face. They had never seen anything like it.
Yeah.
And they loved it. I mean, the applause, the people went crazy for it, because they had never seen anything like it.
Yeah.
It was just an amazing, amazing performance.
It's incredible. And then, you know, especially when you're doing the second line, you know, there's this whole history of the actual dance, the actual second line, and the history of the jazz funeral, which is, it's all kind of tied into. And in New Orleans, you know, you've got the concept of the jazz funerals, where you play the somber music as, you know, you're taking the body to the cemetery, and everyone's sad, sort of proceeding, and then the body's laid to rest in the ground, and they say their prayers and everything, and they put the body into the ground. And then after that, the band, the music livens up, and people start dancing in the street, because now the body's, you know, ascended to heaven, everyone's excited. And then that's where you get the second line, and people dancing, and dancing with the umbrellas in the street and everything. Mm. And it's, you know, just this incredible cultural thing that's part of growing up in the South and in New Orleans.
Yeah, another reason for this pandemic, Dan. We need to make a trip to New Orleans, man.
Yes, sir.
You show me around, bro.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Well, you know, when this all ends, we'll definitely make that trip.
Yeah.
Well, fellas, this was great.
Yeah.
We're coming up on our time, but this was a great conversation. Dean Smith, appreciate you.
Yeah, you know, that's what's great. I tell people I have one of the best jobs in the world, because I get paid to get educated. I just learned so much more from just having this conversation with both of you, you know? Yeah. And so, you know, our college is continuing to move forward and celebrate. And I believe they might play an expert from Mr. Rujako D and Justice Miles, because we do have, you know, we do recognize the African-American culture within the College of Fine Arts. So, you know, we have African dance, we have a gospel choir that's involved. And so you know, I'm moving things forward in that direction and hoping to get more recognition for who we are as a Black people through the College of Fine Arts, and combining that culture with our rich Hispanic and Native American culture as well. So.
Yeah, absolutely.
Pleasure to be here.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. Thank you.
And enjoy the conversation.
These are great conversations to have and get stimulated in February and in Black History Month, but there are definitely conversations that we want to keep going throughout the year and years to come.
Like the music, the conversation should never die.
Yeah. Exactly. Well, Mike, Dean Smith, thank you both. And thanks, everybody, for joining us for this Lobo Living Room session. And we'll continue the conversations. And go Lobos.
Yeah, go Lobos.